me just get to my presentation. No, there we are. Guys, my name is Harshad, and I work on the Gojek iOS team inside what we call the platform team of our company. And inside the platform team, I am in charge of architecting Gojek and making high-level changes into the structure of our app. So this is a second glimpse at what our app looks like, and it is very different from most apps you see on the App Store, because like Mansi said, we are not an app, we are an app of apps. Just to recap what we do and what the app looks like, we do ride-hailing with multiple types of vehicles, we do food delivery, we do groceries delivery, and even shopping, anything that you can imagine. And we do digital payments, so every product of ours can work with our own digital payment system, which also does rewards. And we're also into booking event tickets, movie tickets, and couriers, and lots more. So at a glance, in a technical sense, we have 18 products, which are all part of one app, and we are adding more of them as we speak. We are currently active in 5 countries, and we are adding or working in more countries. And this entire app is managed by 25 engineers in our iOS team, and of course we are growing over there as well. And at the end of the day, we compile about 500,000 lines of pure SWIFT code. So every time you submit to the App Store, or every time you want the entire app to run, we have to compile about 500,000 lines of SWIFT code. And this is where our core problems begin. So we have all of these products, and the thing is, they all sort of depend on each other, or they rather depended on each other, up to some sense, meaning that GoFood couldn't work unless GoRide was also built, and GoRide couldn't work unless we had some support from GoPay or GoPoints code. And in order to build everything, it used to take us like about an hour, because it was just one project into which we had about 500,000 lines of code. And with a team of about 25, we saw daily merge conflicts, particularly in the Xcode's PBX merge file. And we had an overall inconsistent UI between our apps. This is because apps just chose to update themselves independently of each other. So a few things we tried. First one was to just log and analyze the overall build times of the app. The first command over here, which you would just enter in the terminal, should show your overall build time in the Xcode status bar. And the second one would actually log individual function compile times in the build log of Xcode. With this, we identified a bunch of culprits that we think were contributing to this problem we had. First one was type inference. Now, as you all know, inside Swift, when you declare a var, and if you even give a value to it, you do not need to specify what that type is. For example, if you say var message equals to hello, then you do not need to specify that message is a string. Turns out that really locks down the compiler when it comes to complex expressions on the right-hand side, which is why type inference contributes to your overall build time. The second one was having too many files in a large project. This happened because we had about more than 1,000 Swift files into our Xcode project. And once you reach to that level, Xcode just stops caching, which means that incremental builds take almost as much time as clean builds. So that was the second problem. When you have too many variables, which are either internal or public, into your project, say one class has a bunch of internal variables and the other class is somehow using them, and if you end up just changing one of those classes, Xcode tends to build both of them. So this is something that we observe as well, which also results in slower incremental builds. And the last one was having cyclic dependencies, meaning that class A depends on class B on C, and C back on A. And in this case, if you end up compiling any one of these, or rather, if you end up changing any one of these classes, Xcode will end up building all three of them again. So, there are a number of easy fixes that you can do right now. They do not require a lot of code changes into your project. The first one is just specifying types in complex expressions. So if you have an expression with, say, a nested collection, you can just specify the type of that variable beforehand, and Xcode would take much less time to compile it. Reducing the number of exposed vars. Exposed here means internal or public functions and properties inside your types. Making classes final. And there are a few other things, or mostly things that disable Xcode's optimizations. And we do this in the debug variant of the app, so that at the release end, we want all the optimizations to be there. But when you're in the debug mode, that is where you'll be doing most of your work, we just disable most of these things. And this helped us, and this took us a bit far, and it took us for, or rather it made made working with the project a lot easier. But as and when we added more projects, we ended up with more code, and whatever little gains we got from these were all gone away. So we had to architect our app in an entirely new way. And for each, we set up a few goals. The first one was selective compilation. This means that if you're working on a particular project, you should only need to compile that product and not the rest of the app. So you somehow have to figure out a way to reduce the number of code that you compile when you're working on it on a day-to-day basis inside Gojek. The second one was making a plug-and-play platform. So we are entering many countries now, including Philippines, Vietnam, and you might not launch with all projects in all of those countries. So what we want to do is we should be able to create a variant of Gojek with just a bunch of those projects that we have and support in those regions. We wanted this to be extendable, maintainable, and declarative. Who doesn't? And we wanted to avoid imposing a particular structure or a programming style on our product teams. This means that we do not want to force our product developers to, say, work in a reactive programming way or in Viper or in any other manner. The last one allowed us to improve our performance to a great level. So when we are testing or profiling one product, we do not want any code from any other product to be executing at the same time. This meant that the product should be completely sandboxed when it comes to testing, QA, and profiling it. So, and the first step was splitting Gojek into multiple frameworks. At the platform, we have a new framework, which we call Launchpad, which is basically the brains of our app. And we have another helper framework called Asphalt, which does our design language system. So Launchpad is more like Foundation. Asphalt is more like UI kit for you. And after that, we moved every project into its own framework, and every framework in its own repository. The moment we did that, we ended up eliminating all our merge conflicts, because the number of people committing to a single repository just dropped down significantly. So, a bit about Launchpad. So Launchpad is the platform layer between Gojek and Gojek Vortex. And its core job is to display and launch products, or display the home screen and take user to the right product. Apart from that, it routes notifications, deep links, and all external events that you get in a standard iOS app. It also takes care of analytics, running A/B tests, and other growth-specific features. And now it also provides region-specific configuration, meaning that an app which is launching in Philippines would have a significantly different UI and a configuration compared to the app launching in Indonesia. So, we looked at a lot of places for inspiration on how we could design an app of apps. We looked at Viper, we looked at reactive functional programming, and a lot of things that are very popular these days. But nothing really answered what we were trying to do at Gojek. So if you look at any iOS app, take Gojek for example, it can be coded in a reactive manner, it can be coded in a functional manner, it can be very strong OO Viper-like code, but iOS knows how to communicate with this app, regardless of how that app internally is implemented. And it does so via your application delegate. So what you can say is, Your application delegate is like a normalized interface to every app. That's where you get all your lifecycle events. That's where you get all your external events that are coming in into your app. And that's where a chunk of your code, or rather your code, begins to execute from. We use the same thing with Launchpad and our projects. So instead of depending on a project or importing it into Launchpad, we just normalize the interface of every project, and then we could communicate with it via a weekly bound way. And that protocol we call Launchable. And every project product is in the end Launchable, meaning it has a common interface to itself, meaning that Launchpad doesn't need to specifically import GoRide to show GoRide in the home screen on GoCheck. So, Launchable does these things at the very minimum. It has its own catalog and a cart. For example, GoFood has a list of restaurants and a way to place orders from them. Then it knows how to make a booking, take an order, place it. It shows booking details for an order, whether you're coming in from a previously completed order from history, or whether it's an ongoing order. It handles promotions, vouchers, and all of our growth-related stuff. It has its own analytics and A/B testing flows inside of it. And it also redirects to other projects. For example, inside GoFood, if you run out of GoPay, you can just click on top up and you'll be redirected to a different product to top up your GoPay balance. This is what the protocol looks like for Launchable. At the very minimum, we have an image, a name, and an identifier by which we identify that Launchable. And there are interfaces to present or redirect to a particular screen inside of the app. This is just a part of it. This is what I could fit in my slides, but the real one has many more things in it. So, with this, what we could do is build a plug-and-play platform. So the major chunk of your code, of GoCheck, now goes from GoRide, the application target, inside Launchpad, the framework, meaning that creating the main primary interface with our tab bars, our navigation controllers, is all managed by Launchpad. And the product framework, GoRide, just has the product-specific screens inside of it. Now, if you want to create an app which just has GoRide in it, and if you are, say, the GoRide team that does this, then you just need to import GoRide and Launchpad into your target, and you're all set. This also means that you only compile GoRide and Launchpad, and you don't compile 90% of the code. And you can add as many product frameworks as you want. The more you add them, the more icons you get on the home screen. This is the V1 GoCheck app, which launched in about 2 years back. And we launched with 3 products at that time. And recreating it was very simple, again, by just adding these 3 frameworks into the app. And when it comes to launching on the App Store, we just take all our product frameworks, we take Launchpad, and we create the actual GoCheck app and push it out to the App Store. So, summarize, these were our achievements. And so, clean building a single project took less than a minute. And this is after the easy fixes that I've shown you before. And just the matter of fact that a project has 10 times as less code as the entire project app. So just it's almost instant. And clean building all projects took less than 4 minutes. Now, this is not just because of the new architecture, it's also because in a distributed manner in which we wrote code, meaning that we have very few public or open members inside of these frameworks, meaning that changing one framework did not result in changing or rebuilding all of those frameworks. We also reduced the platform code when we wrote Launchpad by 80%. That's a lot, that's a huge number for us. And we could profile our app in a much more meaningful manner. And this all resulted in a much faster app launch time. So, that's pretty much about Launchpad, our foundation at GoCheck. Now, I want to talk a bit about how we do UI at GoCheck. So, at GoCheck, we treat UI as a separate product, just like we treat GoRide and GoFood. This means that our UI framework developers have their own team of engineers and designers, and they all work together, creating a UI framework especially for Gojek. With this, we have a design language system, which is basically a bunch of components that we design throughout the entire app. So these are just a few of them, but we have all our buttons, we have our cards, and what we do is, when it comes to designing screens, or when it comes to launching bigger features, we just combine smaller components like this together into larger screens. And our teams are independent, our UI team are only assigned to designing these base level components with each other. And we call it Asphalt, and these are basically the goals of Asphalt. One is to get a consistent look and feel across all our products. Second one is to get rapid and easy redesigns. And we sort of learned this the hard way when we redesigned GoRide a few months back, when it was just difficult to put all of that into other products unless we had a common design language system between all of our products. We have independent UI and UX engineering. This means that our UI and UX teams do not work on product-specific features, they don't work on network requests, they don't write database queries, they only work on the UI independently of the rest of the company. And we ensure we have pixel-perfect UIs with every build that we make, and I'll just demonstrate shortly how we do that. And the last and the most important thing is we want our documentation to be accessible throughout the company, meaning that if you have the source code, you have an entire collection of what our UI looks like along with this documentation. So I'm just going to demo that. I hope this is visible down at the back.
Increase the font?
Yeah, sure. How about now?
Yeah.
Alright, cool. So UI has a separate app, and of course we don't launch it on the App Store, but this is what we use internally. So every component inside of Gojek goes inside this app. Here is an article card, for example, and these are all interactive. You can play with them. You can see how they scale. And these are the various alert type cards that we have inside our app. You can play this and make this interactive. And when it comes to designing a particular screen, the product developers who want to use these components can just drag and drop these into their NIP files. All of these are IP designable as well. And you can just drag and drop these into their NIP files. And most of the times your work is done over there. In order to ensure that these components stay healthy or stay pixel perfect, over the course of the time, we run UI tests on them, and these UI tests are done in a snapshot basis, meaning that when you run this project and run the test, it goes inside and it clicks on every component inside this catalog, and it checks every state of that component, and then it takes a screenshot of each one of those states. We compare these with a reference image that we have, or that we add to the project the moment the developer designs a new component, and use core image to subtract these two images. And what we do is we ensure that the images are exactly the same with every build. So we run automatically, and we ensure that you don't push anything to the UI repository unless you pass all your test pass. Let me just show you a demo of what happens if I screw up. We just get rid of, say, just come in this line of code here and try to run the button test. So, what I've done is I've just removed the line that sets the title text of the button. So, the button is obviously missing a title text. And if something like this happens, the test for that button fail. There you go. So once the test fail, we just don't want to stop over there. what we want to do is we want to record what exactly we did. And what we do is we take a screenshot of the part that was the difference between the image, the reference image, and the reference that the image actually rendered on the screen. So these are the three steps where it's failing. So that's about it. Last one is about documentation. We have a small tool we have written for it. And this is what the documentation looks like. This has most of our components that we have in SPARC right now. And these images are taken from the reference images generated by our UI tests. So every time we add a component, this immediately comes up on our design website. And if you go inside a component, you can see all of its predefined states, or all of the states where this component can be in. For example, this is all of our error cards inside our app. These are all the kinds of errors that you can get in Gojek. And apart from that, you also have a documentation which we generate with Jazzy. Jazzy automatically generates your documentation for you, even if you haven't documented anything. It at least prints out the public variables and properties of all your classes. So yeah, that's pretty much how we do things at Gojek. And I would like to open this for questions now. Does anyone have any questions? Yep.
Between the 1 hour compile time and the 4 minutes, how long did the refactor take?
So that's a good question. So the refactor took 2.5 months to do, and it took 1 month to QA. It was done by 3 people from the platform team, and yeah, it was a very exciting thing that that happened to Gojek.
So the 1 hour compile time, right? Was it on the latest version of Swift, or was it on Swift 1.2 or earlier version of Swift?
Yeah, so the 1 hour compile time was on Swift v3.2. On Xcode 8, I believe. So that was back in June 2017, and yeah, it has struggled us a lot.
Are you using pods or cartridge?
So for external dependencies, we use pods. In fact, we even had pods for our own internal frameworks before we moved to a more submodule-based approach. So one of the things that we tried before the re-architecture was to pre-compile most of the code that doesn't get updated frequently and then distribute it as a pod, so that we just end up compiling lesser code.
So you have this escort framework that all your repositories are using. So what happens when you want to bump that version? Will all frameworks be affected?
No. So like I said, it's not up to the frameworks that get affected. Frameworks can park to a particular version of escort. So instead of like you would write a version in protocols, you can just write a git tag over there. So it's literally the same thing. Any more questions? Yep.
Also, the app startup time is reduced 30%. So please tell me more about the reason.
Sure. So what used to happen is we had a monolithic app, which is like the app and all of the products were in that one app, and at one time, what used to happen is there used to be so many unnecessary classes that used to get created because of this. So, to give an example, the right engineering code would add a code inside the app, so as soon as the app launches, you run, say, an effort request to fetch something from the server, and the same thing the GoFood team would do, and some other teams would do the same thing. What Launchpad does is it abstracts the app launch process away from the app, away from the products, meaning that products don't know when the app launched. Launchpad tells them when they launched, and that only happens when you click on the app icon. So it sort of like enforces apps from running any code unless the user explicitly clicks on the app. Any more?
Do you use static framework or dynamic?
So all of these frameworks are dynamic, since they are Swift frameworks. You can't make a static framework with Swift. But in case we had some objective C code, we would be forced to do it in a static way.
Dynamic framework also can be used for startup time.
Yeah, that's true. Dynamic frameworks do use, because the DLOpen command does take a bit of time to link all the frameworks, but it only applies for third-party frameworks, not for system frameworks.
How do you guys manage the localization for the
Godic app? So Godic has like two ways of localization. One way is using the system defaults to just use localized file and do it. The second one is we have an in-app menu to change the app language. So that requires us to have our own localization layer in between the system and our app. And what we do with localization is we have a tool which takes in an Excel sheet, which is what most of our translators give us, and it converts it into a Swift file with a list of constants and their values in different languages. Then we add this directly to the app inside the string bars. So we try to automate as much as we can. This is all in the documentation without any intervention from the developer. We also have tools to slice assets from Sketch and put them directly into an XC assets file, put it into the app. And one of the things we are working on right now is to just compare assets that you add to the app versus assets that you already have in the app and make sure that there are no duplicate assets being added. Yep.
So how your app communication is other? Like, because you view your application as a framework, right? So maybe in the past, you have to communicate with them.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
Do you like Mike?
So your app, the app and apps, so that you view is your app is a framework, right? So how do you communicate between two applications? Yeah.
Yeah, so that's a very interesting question. How do we communicate between two apps? One way to do that was to import one product framework into the other, but that would have just gotten us back to not being able to compile just one framework at a time. So we use various modes here. One is via notifications. So if you have a notification, it's pretty bad one. It's a text, it's a string that can be imported anywhere. So that's one way, which we use very sparingly. The second way is using deep links. So each and every one of our project already knows how to handle a deep link that's coming to it. And it can redirect or do anything that it needs to do with a deep link. We use the same thing inside our products as well. So when it comes to GoFood communicating to GoPay to drop off a particular amount, GoFood just opens a deep link with the base URL pointing to GoPay and the amount in the query parameters of the URL, basically. So this means that they don't have to depend or import each other, but they still can communicate with each other.
For this, we want to send some data or request.
Yeah, that's true. So you can't just send like a chunk of data over there. So in those cases, we have a shared storage inside which Launchpad exports. And although it's shared as in it's not a singleton, it's like shared between multiple projects. And so this project basically sends a message to Launchpad saying that, hey, this is some data I would like to expose to this particular project. And if that project accesses it, we just check it based on the service ID and then allocate it with that data.
Yep.
How do you decide your nick link? Is that the map between the page and the URL? Or it's going to be like, you pass a URL and then it comes to the first page and then the page will push down the data into the navigation chains.
Sure. So every deep link first comes to Launchpad, and every product has a property, every launchable has a property called a base link, which identifies a base path rather, which tells us two things. One, whether this deep link belongs to this product, and two, what all deep links this product handles. So once it comes to Launchpad has an array of all the possible products in the app, and it just iterates through them and passes it along to the right product. And deep links can have two ways. One is fire and forget, meaning that if you want to just go to a screen, you can just fire a deep link saying gopay/topup, for example. It goes directly to the top up screen. The second one would be a way to get that target screen inside the other project. So that way would be go pay slash top up and with the parameters in that get screen or I forget what the exact parameter is, but in that case, instead of showing that screen, the project would instead return a view controller, which the quality would then decide how to display.
As you mentioned, like this one application contains 16 apps,
yeah.
Right? But I just checked, like on App Store, its IP size is around 100 MB. So it means like 100 divided by 16 is around 7 MB per app.
No, it's not evenly distributed across all apps. So some of them are like they are sharing assets, and some of them are heavy in terms of assets, some are light.
So my question is like, are you going to use user data to download the assets, or it's inbuilt in the IP?
So all the assets, yeah.
If it's in the IP, then how come it's 100 MB? So.
So here's the fun part: most of our size inside the IP is not the assets; it's the binary itself. So. This is something weird that we found out. Our binaries, when Gojek was a monolithic app, they used to go to about 70 to 80 MB, the binary of Gojek itself. And what we are optimizing on right now is there are a few new settings in Xcode 4, which allow you to, sorry, Xcode 9, which allow you to choose between a faster app or a smaller app. So we are playing around with the settings, and as well as compressing assets as much as we can. But like you said, no, we don't have any assets that are downloaded after you install the app. They're all there in the app.
I have one more question.
Sure.
So one of your problem is cyclic dependencies. So how do you solve that?
Yes. So cyclic dependencies, best way to solve is user protocol. If you're not sure that if you have three teams depending on each other, instead of them depending on each other, keep the protocol in between and separate them out. So instead of depending on a concrete class or a concrete type, it would just depend on a protocol which itself doesn't depend on anything.
Okay.
Sure.